each other?
Just even for
5-10 minutes, if that's okay?
Good, I'll put on the timer. And we're recording. This is your week, my friend. We are talking about shame. I could add music to this.
Just one second. Yeah, I know. It's my own little office. It
are
is.
Done in here?
Who's there?
They are done. They out of here. Yeah, I'm just in the gym here, so just one second.
Okay, that's fine.
Okay, that's just so. Anyway, you were. It was my week.
It's your week. And we're talking about shame. Shame on you.
Well, I could talk about that anytime.
I know, it's your favorite subject. Well, why not?
Well, I guess. Is it my favorite? I wouldn't say it's my favorite subject. I just have a...
I know, I had to call.
I don't know, favorite, that's such an odd way to say it. I love shame. You know what I mean?
Well, you have considered it for a long time. You've been thinking about it.
No, but I like what you said. It's just funny. Shame is it's a favorite in the sense of I think it's an important topic to discuss so people don't get ashamed of shame, which is the problem.
Yeah.
Because people don't want to talk about it. It's like being depression. Remember, people are afraid of saying they're depressed. Less than they used to be, but it's getting better, but they're still ashamed to it. And if you have a problem talking about a topic, you now have if you want to talk about a feeling, and you have a problem talking about that feeling, now you're having a feeling about that feeling,
sure,
which makes that original feeling exponentially escalated in distress most of the time. So that's the important thing I want to mention about that. So what would be, can you hear me okay with this music?
Yeah. I mean, it's, you know, it's there, but I hear you.
It's very like this.
I think it's more the conversation that I'm hearing outside, the conversations behind you, but it's fine. Your voice is clear.
There's no conversation behind me. No. Anyway, I think that's the radio. I'm gonna change it in a minute.
All right.
So, anyway, do you want to ask me some questions with that? Or?
Well, the thing that's big right now is about how are you thinking about shame in the conditions that we're in now, especially white shame shame related to the civil unrest that's happening in the U.S. right now. So personal and community shame.
That's a great question. So you're thinking about whites being ashamed of themselves during this time?
Well, there's reflection.
What do you mean by that?
Reflection being asked. I mean, it's reflection and shame. So talk about reflection and shame. Let me go back and tell you what I've looked at. Robin DiAngelo, have you ever looked at anything that she's written or presented?
I don't recall.
She's written a book called White Fragility, and she's given talks.
Yes. Okay. I know. I talked about her yesterday.
You did. Okay. Okay. Go ahead. Yeah. Tell us
I need more time probably to elaborate a little bit, but I think it's definitely a liberal problem. You know, this white fragility, is it supposed to be blaming the white person? Is that how you hear that?
I don't think so. I think it's just asking to understand what our privilege is built on and recognize that if we had not had the kickstart in this country on enslaved people's backs, then we wouldn't be here in this comfort that we have today and be able to walk on the street without fear and be able to, that a police car who's supposed to protect us may not protect us at all, and quite the contrary, which is what's going on. So that's white fragility and shame of that and the rage that comes from that. And I think you've talked about that with your father, not when he doesn't understand reflection he gets angry. Is that correct? Oop, was frozen. Are you there? Oh, dropped out. No. There we are. There we are. Oh, so that's how you feel about that question.
you found me. Yeah, it's funny.
Yeah. Oh, but that I'm going to push. What? Go ahead and continue on the liberal problem.
Okay. I don't have enough to talk about I need more time to talk about the white fragility thing, honestly. But if we mm-hmm. talk, let's come back to that later. I think it's important because it's been coming up now, and I think it's going to get more defined over the next couple of weeks.
Yeah.
Shame about shame. Let me think of an example. The liberal problem is that I remember I took a workshop from Mort Saul.
Yeah.
And he's still alive.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah. He's about 84, and every Thursday he is at the Throckmorton, and not since COVID. He's had some health problems, but now I guess he may come back. I mean, depending on if they do this.
So he lives in Mill Valley. Wow.
Because they prop him up in one of those front rooms in Throckmorton and just let him talk about whatever he talks about. He has 200 biographies. He left me with a sentence that stuck with me. And it was, heterosexual white men are not welcome in the Democratic Party. And when I heard that, that was a complete drop down menu of what the fuck are you saying? What does that mean? And this is about a year and a half or 2 years ago, he said this, maybe a year and a half ago. Okay. And, what I'm realizing is that an uber liberal will embrace the most disenfranchised. That is the goal of an uber liberal, I think he's saying, where somebody who's not so disenfranchised will not be as accepted in that way. So when you're dealing with racism and you deal with somebody liberal, they're just going to want to blame themselves and their own white privilege in this a lot, which I don't know if that's helpful at all. This is a much bigger topic, but I want to bring it back to shame. I don't think, you know, it's so hard because we're not, I think when I go with this is there's so many different ways to look at shame and the unrest with Black Lives Matter and all this, but it really goes back to it is that we're not them. I'm never going to be Black.
No.
I'm never going to convince them. I may have eloquent use of language that I'll talk to somebody that's in pain because of racism, and perhaps I can use language in a way that helps them to understand that I understand them. So, but the best I could do is empathize with them because
that's
I'm not
all.
Them.
I think that's all that I can do. I think that's all that's being asked is.
However,
okay.
Yeah, I agree, but I think empathy, the thing about empathy is, I'm going to give you a story about empathy with, I'm talking about shame, but we're coming back to empathy because it's the answer to this is, I had a friend who I was supposed to get together with dinner with him, and I hadn't seen him in a while. And I had mixed feelings about getting together with him. And I don't know if I mentioned this in one of our sessions, but anyway. And I couldn't get a hold of him or something, or I felt bad because I had twisted my ankle or whatever. And he goes, I wish you would have let me know sooner. I would have made plans with somebody else. So, and I felt really conflicted. And I go, well, I'm sorry. Number one, he had no empathy for me and my injury. That's one thing. And I wasn't even sitting in that. I go, well, I'm really sorry. And then I said the phrase, well, I just wanted, like I said, well, I'm in pain. Can you even see that? I mean, I just wanted you to empathize a little bit. I'm really sorry. He goes, I empathize with you. You weren't there to receive it. Hmm. Now, number one, that's the last time I talked to that guy again, the last time. Mm-hmm. He does not have an understanding of empathy, because my understanding of empathy is if the receiver doesn't get it, then you didn't give it. They have to feel it. So if we go back to Black Lives Matter in this part, is that if you're saying all they're looking for is empathy, they have to be able to feel it. They ain't feeling it right now. That's pretty clear. No matter what the babble, babble, boo, 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 all this white shame, all this stuff that's happening, they're not feeling it. I don't know if that's all they want. Maybe that is all they want. They're not getting it.
Well, first of all, I think them is dangerous, and
but
I hear what you're saying, but then
as far as the problem is concerned, there is an us them to some degree. I know I hate that too, but there is, because there's a difference. There is a difference.
But I also think there is an acceptance of just listening and being and standing up and reflecting on the white privilege that we have. That 10 minutes has just gone by. It's 10:05 now.
Can we talk just another couple more? Because you're making a point.
Sure.
So I don't want to.
Sure. So I think the white privilege is that I think the reason for the protest is just saying again, as it was in 2014, 2015, 2016, when Between the World and Me came out from Ta-Nehisi Coates, talking to his son about 2015, Trayvon Martin and Ferguson, and trying to explain to his son how to be in the world. Have you read that book? It's very gentle, actually. It's beautifully gentle. It's as if the writer is sitting down beside you and not holding your hand, not doing anything, but just there, no energy. And I think that's what's out there now, is people are out there together asking for change. The police brutality and the cover-ups because of that, and the reason and the punishment for killing unarmed black men hasn't happened. It's been, you know, swept off under the rug. People have gotten off. Some have gone through, but it differs in places. And so it's calling for reforms there. I mean, the statistics are easy to see. And so folks are just saying, let's be a different world. Let's innovate around this, because it's coming up. And it is an untreated wound. It's part of the untreated wound.
Feels like this kind of thing has so many, when I hear you talking, I hear it as, you know, we're always trying to get into higher ground of understanding with this, you know, that's why we're talking, we're always trying to get to higher ground, but there are too many higher grounds or too many hills to climb, because there's so many different perspectives to look at.
It's
so
ongoing. I agree.
So I think you have to take in as many, it's like having an understanding of any problem. You take in as many angles as possible to understand what's happening. And
yes,
even though I feel like I'm on top of the mountain now to understand, there's going to be another thing over here that I didn't understand that now I have to take in. It's really almost an impossible task, but it doesn't mean it's not worth going after.
You're exactly right. And this is what the conversations are now. What are the day-to-day individual things that we can do? One is listen and empathize, but there could be actually, you know, one thing that we do, or for instance, well, read and listen is one, but you know, when we encounter a black person, or if we walk into a room and there's no diversity there, then question that. That's one thing, I think. And what is
also here? The whole thing too, it's gone in so many directions that seem even ludicrous to me. The feeling isn't, I may hear things that sound ludicrous to me on the surface. It doesn't mean the feeling behind them is ludicrous. And I'm trying to separate those two, which is a really big deal. It's like when somebody has a problem, you know, I'll hear what there was a woman that was black who was younger in charge of, you know, there's that thing where the younger people are going to save the world because they don't have faith in the older people. There's that dynamic and that bullshit. I mean, it sounds bullshit on the surface with that, but it doesn't mean there isn't something behind it. Then there's the black woman with a megaphone who's really like, goes, we're looting the streets because you made us loot the streets. That sounds ridiculous just on the cut front to me, but behind the emotion, there's something deep there. I'm not, it's almost like these, there are these little table of contents things around and people, their stuff, and people are not going to buy that stuff if it's not in their experience. So my point is that you don't empathize with even what they're saying or what they're doing. You empathize with their feeling. It goes deeper than what you're even hearing. That's a very different thing. Okay, I'll give you an example personally in my life. Somebody was complaining about something, about not having any money. I know for a fact this person owns 3 homes. Mm. Now,
well, it wasn't me. It wasn't me.
No. And I know this, but then I realized this person is cash poor in the moment, but has 3 homes. So my thinking, because I'm not them, if I were to be logical, a lot of people would think, well, why would I empathize with that? Or why do I care about that? They have 3 homes. They're just babbling about something. That's a common way to look at it. I know more about this person because I have more information, is that they can't sell the homes right now, or they don't want to. They're cash poor, and they really do feel like they have no money in that moment. I'm empathizing with her feeling, not with what I view her status as. Sure. That's where we're not doing any of that yet. We're not there yet. We're trying to empathize with what they're telling us, not with what they're feeling below, which takes more work and excavation to get there.
Yes.
That's,
I mean, and that's those are the phases of demonstration too, right? There's the frontline demonstration that's public.
Yeah, there you go. Right.
Working within, and yeah, so you're right also in that this is just the top, and there are many layers. And
me too, same thing. Me too, yeah, is exactly the same,
yes,
thing.
Yes, listen and ask. And it's not business as usual when tensions are gone, and tensions mean growth. Discomfort means growth. And yeah, so, you know, in a way you almost, you don't go out
looking
for it.
You have to be comfortable. You got to go through the conflict. You got to go through the conflict. I try to get used to being comfortable, being uncomfortable.
Yes. Yes.
You know, like Eleanor Roosevelt.
Go ahead, Eleanor Roosevelt.
It's a quote that's on mugs and things. I hate quotes, but this one,
quotes
in this
on mugs.
Context, I like it. What? Yes.
Quotes on mugs. Go ahead, I want to hear it.
Right. I mean, I hate this stupid shit, but I mean, it's fine for this context. It works. Those things work in a specific context. People try to live their lives by quotes. That doesn't work. It works in specific context in the moment. Would be, try to do something that makes you uncomfortable every day. So as in this context, because we're already talking about it, it makes sense, because there's all this backstory about what we're talking about that led me to this quote. And there's, but you know, you just pull quotes out of nowhere. They just sound, just shut up, bitch. It just sounds stupid or dismissive by the quote. But here it's hard to be uncomfortable. You got to get used to it.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
And I think this is what, and this is, and I am speaking to the white person right now with that, in this instance. I'm not going to ask a black person to do that in this context, because that takes a lot more for me to say that. But right now I can say it because it's my personal experience, and I'm of that, the race that I happen to be born into. I am going to, which I've heard that, you know, seriously, is I'm going to say that to a white person, is that it takes, you have to learn to be uncomfortable with some things.
And so that I think is a really great learning tool. Is what do we do when we feel uncomfortable? Do we fall forward or fail forward into our aspired behaviors? Or do we clench up and fall back and go back into old behaviors that, and that's where the rage comes from, our reaction to discomfort.
If I had a rap song, and I wanted to make a rap song about it, which is actually in the background here, rap music, it's funny, is I would say, lean into the pain, bitch. Lean into the pain. That's what I would do. I'd say lean, because that's what you're saying. You're saying either lean into the pain or you recoil from the pain.
Right.
Because pain is pain.
Right.
It does a lot of things for us. But lean into this pain. I think we need to leave it there for today.
I think so, too. I though have a hard time, and I wonder if other people do, when we say pain, I think of something cutting me rather than discomfort.
I think we have to then define the different kinds of discomfort. and make that more inviting to feel.
Invite me to discomfort. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, but you're right. You're right. This is exactly it. And Don Lemon, the CNN news guy, is doing a podcast on this. And there's, I think, a football player in the South who's doing this too. Uncomfortable conversations with the black man, it's called. Oh, here it is. Uncomfortable conversations with the black man. It doesn't say who. Emmanuel Acho is his name. A-C-H-O. And that's a podcast. So two good things. And then we have Robin DiAngelo and Carol Anderson. Carol Anderson's also a really great speaker. Oh, those are four. Woo!
So I'm going to give you an example. I just got a text from a client who just illustrated about what's the problem with being uncomfortable. Just got a text about it. And I'm going to read it to you. How about if we end with that? Okay.
Oh, good. Okay.
It's somebody who's in pain physically. We're talking more about more emotional pain, but pain physically, that they have to get treated by somebody and the treatment makes them more uncomfortable and more in pain. But then when we went through it a couple of times, it was less painful. So it goes up and down with pain, but they're seeing the relief. It's sort of like one step forward, two steps forward, one step back. Mm-hmm. The treatment is painful, two steps forward, one step back, and they have to stick with it. That was a perfect, it's physical pain, but it's the same thing emotionally, is that you have to get used to it. It's gonna make you feel things you don't wanna feel. It'll make you feel shameful, embarrassed, stupid, scared. People don't wanna feel those things. They run away from them. But if you get used to them, it doesn't mean you're gonna die from them. But it is in our positive thinking culture that you're gonna die from feeling these things, get rid of those things all the time. But you have to take them on.
Right.
So, but it takes time to learn how to do that. I don't mean to say just take it on, bitch, just do it. It's hard to do it. And we need to be invited and we need practice and learning and education to do that.
Exactly. But it is a biofeedback mechanism. What happens when you feel that pain? That's great. And how you behave. And that is an answer, I believe. Okay. Thank you, Anthony. Great session. I think I'd like to post this one, actually. You review it, I'll review it.
Okay, all right.
I don't think it needs any editing.
Okay.
Except for you just scratching your butt right there. Pardon me.
I was scratching my calf. I'm being misrepresented as a white man right now, scratching my butt. I'm scratching my calf. Thank you.
Okay, I might edit that. I'm going to say goodbye now, darling. Have a good day. Bye.
Bye.